Not that long ago I checked the Sonic Pad, but was marketed to be a holy grail of easy Klipper for our slow printers. Unfortunately, it didn't live up to the marketing hype and it also ran a modified version of Klipper. So when Bigtreetech reached out asking me if I was interested in their version of the Klipper Pad, at first I was a little bit skeptical. But after I received it and realized it doesn't run a forked version of Klipper, but rather a perfect stock one that the most of 3D printing enthusiasts actually want, I was so relieved. So let's dive deeper and see if Pad 7 is the right choice for you to make a printer go BRRR. Right after this quick sponsor segment by PCBWay. I have been designing all kinds of 3D printer modifications that were made by PCBWay. You can get professional services like PCB manufacturing, CNC machining, 3D printing and way more. And one of the best parts is how it is simple to order parts for your projects, as they have all options well explained and even visualized. So make sure to check them out and also get 5 bucks off for your first purchase, the link in the video description. So the first thing that we need to establish is what this product is made for. You see, I really don't like when companies use big marketing words that in reality mean nothing. And I have to give BTT a lot of credit here. They go straight to the point that this product is made specifically for 3D printing enthusiasts. Klipper is amazing, but it requires a certain amount of knowledge to get going, and if you never dealt with it, you will need to learn things. But because it runs stock Klipper, the documentation and most guides will be universal, so it is a huge plus in my book. They also provide a manual on how to do things that are specific to the Pad 7. In the box we will find a quick guide, the pad itself that has a microSD card with pre-installed Klipper, different adapters for the power brick and all kinds of accessories. The most important of them is the ADXL accelerometer to run the input shaping, and finally the power brick itself. The build quality of the pad seems pretty good, have no complaints here, however buttons feel a little bit cheap. But nothing too bad that would ruin overall experience. And when you turn on the pad for the first time, you will be greeted with Klipper's error message. This means that it is time to make a configuration file for your printer. As this is stock Klipper and there is a plenty of great official documentation on how to do that, I won't be including that in this video. But if you are new and never dealt with Klipper, basically you are getting a pad with it pre-installed and you won't need to do that manually. If your printer is not flash with Klipper, you will need to check the official configuration reference on how to do that. TLDR process is, you find the config file of your printer's motherboard on Klipper's GitHub page. In each file, there are written what options you need to select when making the firmware for your specific board. You connect the pad to your network and using the local IP address, you SSH using, for example, a mobile Xterm application to the pad. Then you log in to the pad, follow the instructions and make a flash file for your specific motherboard using settings that we talked about previously. Then usually you download the file, put it on an empty spare microSD card and flash your printer. After this you upload the config of your board to the pad and connect your printer. Now you can SSH again and by running this command get the address of the USB port that printer is connected to. You copy it to the config file of your printer and you're pretty much done with the basic printer connection setup. What's left is for you to finish setting up your printer configuration if you're using one of the aftermarket boards and setting up the Klipper screen config file, which also has a full official documentation. If you get errors while using some of the commands on the pad, most likely you haven't properly set something up. Like for example as simple as not having a macro for loading the filament. So with all of this out of the way, let's finally talk about the pad itself. To start, one thing that I don't understand is why they promote the touch feedback, but it comes disabled and you'll need to SSH to the pad to enable it. Well, probably because it's a very average touch feedback at best. This leads us to the sounds, as this pad has stereo speakers on the back. They are fine, but you can't save sound level and after restart of a pad, the speakers will blast full power. However, you can do some cool stuff with them.
Hey YouTube, I am Pad 7 and I am alive. Ha 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 ha.
Yes, you can configure the pad to play your custom sounds with G-code commands. You won't be playing your daily music as the sound quality is quite low. But if you are a max troll, you can set up the pad for your 3D printing friend with some custom sounds. Because why not, right? To do that, we'll need to SSH to the pad and install cow. Then by going to the advanced menu, we need to add the GCODE shell command feature. Then we restart the pad and there will be a new config file by the name of the shell command. Here we paste all these lines and save the file. Now we need a script that plays the sound. We SSH again to the pad and paste more text that I will provide in the video description, then save and exit. Next, we grant permission to execute the script that we created. Now we can type a command and it will play a default touch sound. And to make it play our custom MP3 files, all we need to do is create a folder in the home BQ directory and then just drag and drop files. And the last step is to define the location of those files and create custom command names in the shell command CFG file. And that is pretty much it. One suggestion is to edit your sounds with way lower volume and some delay, as it can sometimes cut off first seconds when trying to play it on the pad. Just remember that to use the sounds and touch feedback features, you will need to run a modified Klipper screen by BTT. Otherwise, you can just run a stock Klipper screen by changing the GitHub link in the Moonraker config and then by doing a hard recovery. Also, important thing to note is that the pad comes with only one instance of Klipper installed, meaning that out of the box you can only connect one printer. I don't think it is a wrong move as it is stock Klipper and you can reconfigure that. The pad is powered by the 12V power brick. It says 12V input, but I asked BTT and they said that you can also power it with 24V. You know what that means, right? You can connect it directly from your 3D printer's power supply. We even include an adapter for you to easily do that. The pad has 3 USB ports, 2 at the back and 1 at the right side. And if you end up switching the CB1 module with one that has integrated storage, there's a USB-C port to burn the image to it. The pad also has a CAN bus communication port that allows you to directly connect expansion boards like EBB. It is definitely more for advanced users, but this way you will only require 4 wires going to the printhead, 2 power and 2 communication wires instead of stack of them. And finally, we have the SPI port that you will be using to connect the provided accelerometer and the audio out port that will allow you to connect, for example, better speakers. The thing that I really like is the adaptive brightness of the screen. As it is quite bright, such a feature is very welcoming as you won't be blinded at low lighting conditions. It is an APS panel that has decent colors and great viewing angles. The only area where it loses to the Sonic's pad screen is the contrast ratio as blacks look slightly washed, but the Pad 7 is so much more responsive to use. Also, you can control it with a mouse and keyboard. If for some reason you want, well, you can. So what is the actual experience while using the pad? I have been running it on my converted KP3S Pro to dual Z access that has a recently replaced SKR Pico board. And man, after the Sonic pad, it is so refreshing to be running stock Klipper that you can configure it as you wish with all the latest features and everything just works. For example, this printer doesn't have a probe, but Klipper screen makes it easy to level the bed and even create a manual bed mesh if you need a small amount of compensation. Sure, you can do all that even on your phone, but it is not the same compared to a proper user interface on a bigger pad. Meanwhile, good luck figuring out how to do that on the Sonic pad as half of the stock Klipper commands just don't work. Want to easily add a new feature like the exclude object to Klipper? It is effortless to do it on the Pad 7 as it runs stock Klipper. But again, good luck doing that on the Sonic pad. And this is the beauty of a Pad 7 in a nutshell. Yes, it requires you to make more configurations, but as they are official and well documented, and then you can have a way better experience tailored specifically for your needs. You are getting the latest and greatest updates because again it just runs stock Klipper without any BS. And then there's the price. Even if we would try adapt only the main parts required to get a similar device like this, we will end up very close to the price of a Pad 7. So BTT doesn't overcharge you for a complete package and makes it very compelling against the others. So yeah, huge thumbs up for the Pad 7. If you want to support the channel, there's an affiliate link for it in the video description. You can also become a patron like all these amazing people do. Or you can simply just give a like and subscribe for more future content like this. Well, that's all from me and I'll see you next time.